Okay, good morning, everyone. Yes, today is the final day of the lecture, and today I'd like to talk about the recent trend of the aeroelastic programs, and also I'd like to introduce some research examples from our laboratory, mainly. So, the textbook, please open the page 81. So the contents is from 82. Okay. So as Professor Mistry talked, so we are now we have for air engine we have a very big fan. It's an big with a big aspect ratio. Yeah, this kind of we have. Yeah, this kind of configuration. So bypass ratio is very high, and accordingly, the fan is very big. So that results in the decrease in the blade rigidity in from the aeroelastic point of view, because we use a high and ultra high bypass ratio for performance improvement. And accordingly, the very large and long blades are used with high aspect ratio. And on the other hand, so for the performance improvement, it's necessary to reduce the weight of the structures. So we are using very thin blades or sometimes hollow structure, hollow blades. And also, we are using composite materials for the fan blades or other blades and other structures. So these all trends of the current technology is result in the decrease in the blade rigidity nowadays. And on the other hand, we are using blisk structure. Blisk is that means a bladed disc, and in the original structure, the blade, each blade has a dovetail or a Christmas tree at the root, and they are put into the disc, okay, slot on the disc. But a blisk is the combined structure of disc and blade, so it's a one piece. Blade and disc is one piece, so it's an And by using blisk, we can get a very right structure, and also the number of components is reduced, can be reduced. So that is beneficial. But in this structure, we don't expect the structure damping, as I told you the day before yesterday. So the structure damping is decreasing. So all these kind of things are connecting to the degrading of the aeroelastic stability. So in one word, so now the flutter is likely to occur. So it's compared with the former time. So that is a very dangerous situation in the current jet engines, okay? And this is an example of the very big fan. It's an PW, Pratt & Whitney engine, but J is Japan, and M is MTU in Germany. So that is three countries' collaboration engines. And Japan, the share of Japan is around 20% or 25%. And low pressure side is made by Japanese side, so especially IHI, and other one is from KHI and Mitsubishi, Kawasaki and Mitsubishi. Okay. And the special feature, current feature, is it has a reduction gear here, because if the fan is bigger, becomes bigger, the tip speed, the peripheral speed of tip is very high. So it's too high, and there is a shock wave, and efficiency is decreasing. That is a problem. So the fan must be rotated slowly. But this is, the fan is driven by the LP shaft. So LP shaft is driven by LP turbine. So if the rotational speed is slow, the turbine, low pressure turbine also rotates with slow speed. So it's not good for LPT. So LPT, we want to rotate LPT in high speed. So the solution is we use this reduction gear. Okay. So now in this engine, the gear ratio is 3:1. So the LPT is rotating very high velocity, rotational velocity, and fan is rotating in slow velocity. Okay. So that is a new or current configuration of the commercial engine. And but in the future, so every industry is planning to make this type open rotor. So bypass ratio is, yes, further higher than this one. But yes, and every industry is testing this configuration. But it's not sure where or when we'll get this rearranging in the open rotor. But it's now an R&D phase. Okay. But anyway, of course, in these configurations, the fan is very big. So the composite material is used for the fan blades. So this situation is an example of the current degradation of the aeroelastic stability. Okay, and we have many unknown factors, and we realize that these are very important factors. So the first one is influence of boundary layer separation, as I told you yesterday, and stall, and also the shock. So this is a main topic of my lecture, and shock boundary layer interaction. These are not fully understood yet. And also we have a factors of mistuning. So mistuning effect is, it's an in the basically the mistuning is beneficial for flutter suppression. So if so the structural characteristics of the all blades is the same, it's a dangerous situation for flutter onset compared with the mistuned case. So mistuning is beneficial for flutter suppression, but for forced response, so mistuning has some unknown effect for the bivalation. So that is a research issue, current research issue, one of the current research issues for mistuning effect on the forced vibration. And also the inlet boundary condition, it means, so for instance for fan, there is an intake and fan, there is a duct. So the pressure wave from the fan face goes upstream and then go out, but the inlet intake of surface of the engine is a discontinuous surface in terms of the unsteady aerodynamics. So the wave, the sum of this wave reflects at the intake face, and then go back to the fan. So that is, of course, this affects the unsteady aerodynamic force on the fan blades. So this is the very important point. So reflection from the intake. That is the one of the inlet boundary condition issue. Okay. And also the periodic perturbation of flow itself. So it's the surge and rotating stall is well known, but some other perturbation can occur in the, some cases. So these are very complicated and unknown aerodynamic factors. So all these are unknown factors. And recently, we have some strange cases of the aeroelastic instability. So due to the mode coupling, so-called mode coupling or mode change. So this is, as I told you yesterday or the day before yesterday, the mass ratio is an critical factor, one of the critical factors. And in former time, the mass ratio is sufficiently high for the compressor blades. So the mode shape of the blade and also the frequency is fixed as a natural frequency of the structure one. But if the mass ratio is decreased, the, this kind of structure characteristics is easily affected by the airflow. So that is an current unknown factor. So, and for instance, this is an example of the non-synchronous vibration. This is a Campbell diagram. As I showed you, it's a rotor speed here, and frequencies here, and these lines is the engine order excitation line, and these lines are the natural frequency of the blades, and in a realistic case, we have a flutter here or here. So flutter is flutter occurs at their own frequency, natural frequency of the blade's structure, shown here. But sometimes we have these kind of vibrations, so it's unknown one. It's called non-synchronous vibration, NSV. That is very important, dangerous situation. And many researches have done for this phenomenon. And now some people say it's related with the flow instability, like a rotating stall, but not rotating stall. So rotating, it's called, for instance, rotating instability. So it's a local, for instance, local tip vortex size like structure rotates along the rotor tip or something. So this kind of flow instability induces this kind of non-synchronous vibration. So it's an issue of the periodic perturbation of the flow itself. But it's not clarified free yet. So this is a research issue. And another example is this right-hand side. It's an also a Campbell diagram, but it's some rotor speed and blade frequency. And only the blade frequencies are plotted here. And these are the original frequency of natural frequency of the blades. And it's a fast bending and second bending, and first torsion. But it depends, the order is depends on the structure. But in this particular blade, the first bending is here, and the second bending is here, and first torsion is here. And this is a realistic, so measured frequency by strain gauge technique. And this, as we expect the frequency always on these curves. But as you see, there's some change. And the first bending and second bending is merged here. And they experience the flutter here. So it means the natural frequency is changed so along the rotor speed. So it means the flow field affect the structure characteristics here. So that is a typical case of the mode coupling. Okay. So in this case, airflow significantly affects the frequency and mode shape of blade vibration. So it's called mode coupling. So these are very complicated and not traditional issues. So we have to tackle these problems nowadays also. Okay. This is an example of the flutter signal and failure. So it's a disastrous, it's a strain gauge response in Campbell diagram. It's a NASA technical paper. It's a fan speed and frequency. And these engine orders. And we have several vibrations here. It's a first three energy resonant responses here. So it's so placed on the three energy, it's an engine order line. So that is a forced response. But the flutter is here. It's a slightly changed, but almost the same frequency here. So slight change is depending on the fan speed, but it's out of these engine order lines. That is a flutter. And in these cases, so we have some failure, very severe failure, yes, like this. So this kind of fluctuation is difficult to be predicted theoretically. So we need to use some numerical simulations for understanding these kind of real machine problems. Okay. So due to existence of lots of unknown phenomena, the integration of experimental measurement and numerical simulation is expected for research development and analysis method establishment of cascade flutter. So important point is that experiment is, of course, necessary. And experimental work and numerical work are combined with each other to get the thorough knowledge of these kind of complicated phenomena. And this is our work. It's examples of a numerical approach. It's performed by Dr. Tateshi, my former assistant professor. And this is an example of the fan, transonic fan, called CEFS1. It's made by IHI. It's tested in the Japanese national project. They have a fan rig, and fan rig test was done here. And the number of blades is 18, and the relative peak tip Mach number is 1.4. The aspect ratio is 1.6, and material is titanium and brisk and stiff disk. It's not a hollow, so there is no mode coupling. Okay. And flutter boundary was detected in their ring test. This is a ring test data of fan map. Again, this is a mass flow rate, and this is some pressure ratio. Okay, and it's an 100% speed line and 90% speed line, and down to 75% speed line here. And as Professor Mistry explained, we'll have a surge point here. It's instability at the 100% speed. And at 90-100%, this is a stall point. Okay. It's not easy to determine the stall point because we put the pressure sensor or velocity sensor inside the field. And we watch the fluctuation. And if the fluctuation is very grows very big, so we will decide this is a stall point, but it's not easy. So we need the skill, high skill, to detect that. But anyway, based on their experience, this is a surge point. And 85% also they found surge, but 82.5% they detected blade vibration. It is detected by the strain gauge mounted on the blade itself. And 80% speed also they found flutter here. But 77.5%, yeah, they found surge, not flutter. and also surge. So only the 82.5% and 80% speed they experienced flutter. And they measured the strain gauge A data on some points, and they found that the structural mode was first fracture, so the lowest mode of the blade. And this kind of boundary is called flutter bite. That is very typical flutter bite data. So as I told you the day before yesterday, so we expect a surge line here. But this is a flutter bite. So it's cut into the operating range. So we usually draw the operating line like this here. But if there is this kind of flutter bite, we have to watch this critical point. So we must have a margin from here. So original operating line must be lowered to here, to this side. So it's a not good side for the performance of the fan or compressor. So we would like to stop this flutter, and want to draw the surge line, only surge line here. So for this purpose, so we must understand what's happening here. That is an aeroelastical research work. So, and the frequency was, motor frequency was 250 hertz. So 1F mode flutter was observed at the stall side of part speed conditions. Of course, the determination of the flutter point is also very difficult. So this signal is very, very fluctuated, very much. So we have to distinguish the flutter signal from the fluctuation. So we need skill also. And the motivation of our numerical work is a flutter assessment technique for future fan and understanding the flow mechanism. And we established a two-way coupled and aerostatic formulation. The objective is to develop a new aerostructural integrated framework for flutter prediction using FSI simulation. FSI is flow structure interact simulation. And to apply the proposed method to fan stall flutter experienced in a ring test. And our approach is combination of type domain FSI and mode identification. And FSI is now popular world, but we coupled this FSI with mode identification, new mode identification technique. And this is a new, it's an all in-house code, and we developed a new one for this purpose. And it's a basic concept only. So aeroelastic system equation and its stability. Then aeroelastic equation of the cascade is then all blades are aerodynamically coupled. It's the same as the theoretical analysis. And it's a number of blades. It's we have 18 blades in whole. And we can have this kind of equation of motion. The Q is the displacement of the each blade. And in the right-hand side, we have A, and B. And each A and B are coefficients of the self-excited force. It's a instability force, aerodynamic force. And if we execute the FSI, flow structure coupled interacted simulation, we can get the real vibration signal from the simulation. But we have only that information. So every blade oscillating in some mode or some interbrade phase angle. So from that results, we must realize, we must find the mold shape or interface or something. So these are the recalculation based on the results of the FSI simulation. So we established a new method for mold identification, for that recalculation of the FSI data. So this is these are identified from the time history of the vibration data. So, and we need aerodynamic, aeroelastic modes and their damping rate. So after determining matrix A and matrix B, the system modes can be obtained via eigen analysis. The solution is shown in this form. And this is a wave number and the eigenvector. And if real part of lambda is negative, or this condition, it's a positive damping. But if the real part of lambda is positive, it's a flatter. And also the damping rate can be calculated by this solution. So this is a new aspect of this, the developed method. So I'll skip the details, but this is presented in the ASME Tower Expo, so you can refer that paper. And identification of a self-exciting aerodynamic force. So if we have applying the components of A and B to an unknown vector, we can make this expression of the equation, and then it's rewrite it, this one. And X and R can be obtained from the instantaneous states. So this is an example, the sketch of the example of the oscillation data. It's obtained by the FSI simulation. And we cut, this is time, and this is an displacement of the blade, okay? And this is vibration data. And we cut the time at the several points. And this, and we can get Q, Q dot, and Q double dot here and here, every point. And we use these input to this equation, and we can rewrite this. And we need this DF, aerodynamic terms. And this, if we use these quantities into this equation, so this equation is an over-determined equation, and we can obtain this one. And aerodynamic terms are obtained by the least squares of the over-determined equation. So this is a rough sketch of the methodology. So from up to this vibration signal, it's an FSI simulation. So this is can be you maybe you can use the commercial code to get this kind of signal. But after you get this signal, you have to reconsider the mode shape and yes, mode shape and damping rate from these signals. And again, this is an analysis model, as I showed you previously. And then we made a numerical work from this specific configuration. Well, and first, we did a structure analysis with FEM of rotating blades. And we can get blade shape and structure modes on each speed lines, and CFD mesh morphing is executed based on the structure analysis. And this is mesh morphing, this near the leading edge. And then we execute steady CFD, so single passage. So we get the steady flow field and fan map for flutter simulation. And based on these steady results, we do the FSI of blade vibration. We use the half annulus 9 blades, not the whole, because of the limitation of the computer cost, computational cost. But it's enough. I think it's enough. The evaluation of damping rate in wind range of operating conditions using FSI and modulated identification is possible for us. So as I told you, we had a method of modal identification. And the numerical CFD code is very normal one. So finite volume and compressive runs coupled with the modal blade motion. The shafts and the second of the central difference and time matching is shown here. And the turbulence model is Sparrat Almaraz, one equation model. And this is a result of the structural analysis, FEM. So 1F to, yeah, to the higher modes. And because in this case, the braid is a titanium braid. So mass ratio is sufficiently high. So we don't have a mode change. So it's fixed. So we considered the first five modes in this computation. Okay, and this is an Campbell diagram. It's a relative rotational speed and normalized frequency. And first, second, flexure. It's an it's a flexure is like bending, but nowadays its a shape is very complicated. So not directly, it's not directly the bending. If we if there is a bending motion, some torsion is added. So first flexure, it's called first flexure. Its shape is here, and second flexure is here, and torsion is this one. The tip is here, and here is very weak. So this one, and third flexure, and edgewise is it's here. It's a three-dimensional. So this point and this point is anti-phase and very weak one. It's an edgewise, called edgewise. So we consider these five lower modes into this consideration. Okay, and this is a steady CFD results compared with the ring test. So it's a fun characteristic curve, characteristic map. And black line and symbols show the ring test data. And purple lines and symbols are the results of CFD simulation. So it's they show very good agreement each other. Okay. And for numerical simulation, we also executed the lower speed line, 72.5% and 70%. And as previously showed, the surge line is here, and flutter was experienced here, and surge here in the ring test. So we tried to find these lines in our numerical simulation. The result is shown here. So red solid line shows the results of the numerical simulation. So we have 82.5%, which we found a flutter point here, and 80% we found flutter point here, and this is a surge. So it's a good agreement with the ring test data. But here, 77.5%, there is no surge in ring test, no flutter in the ring test. They experience surge. But in numerical simulation, we found the flutter point here. And also 75% speed, we also found the flutter point here. So there is a disagreement here in this low rotational speed zone. so lower than 77.5% N, but is predicted in simulations only. So that is a discrepancy, and this is a point of our further consideration or need to understand what's happening here. Okay. And from the simulation results, we can see the flow structure on the braids or near the braids and a whole flow field. So we looked at the details of the flow field. Okay. And these graphs, figures show the local work, and it's 72.5%, 75%, 80%. And these are non-flutter cases. And we see, and this is a local work just shown by color. And the red part is, has a very big work. It's aerodynamic work. And we can easily see the effect of the shockwave here. So we, I don't have a figure of the flow field, sorry, but this is so completely corresponding to the shock position. So shock induces these very big local work. But in the flutter case here, operating point B and C, we can detect the very big area of the local work. So, in the and basically, these figures are similar, but the difference is the position of the local work or shockwave is it's a near leading edge in these cases, or the strength is higher and the area is broader compared with these cases. So this is the cause. It's cause of the flutter instability. So we can say that the behavior of the shockwave is the governing factor in this case. So it's a flow field near the tip, and in the detached shock on the so suction surface contributes the strong excitation in this case. And existing shock on the stall side operating points rules the flutter boundary. Okay. Now this is the findings from the flow field observation. So the mismatch in the flutter boundary may be related to the flow around the shock. That is some findings. So Dr. Tateshi is thinking, so we need to improve the flow simulation to realistic one. And then we are proceeding to the improvement of the flow simulation. But in these areas, it's a near stall region. So the flow field itself is very complicated and unsteady. So we observed the examples of the flow field at this point in this area. It's represented with this point. And this movie shows the unsteady pressure field at the 95% plane here, near tip. So as we can see, there is a rotating stall-like propagation of the pressure wave here. And in this situation, we performed an FSI simulation around here. So it means so the flow itself is inherently unstable or unsteady, and there is some periodic instability in the flow field. And in this case, the separated regions rotate with a frequency around 2500 hertz. So it's much higher than the flutter fluctuation. But the pressure fluctuation caused by the blade vibration might be masked by these flow instability. So that is very difficult to identify the flutter point or this kind of flow instability. That is one problem. So we talked with the IHI people many times on this flow field and flutter. And we suspected, so it's true that there is no flutter. Maybe they missed the flutter point in this part of speed. So IHI people, engineers say, oh, it's possible. Okay, so they don't have a 100% correctness. So they don't have full confidence on this ring test. So hopefully we like to test the rig, but it's already broken for the next project, so we couldn't do that. So important point is hopefully we like to do the ring test experiment and numerical simulation parallel, simultaneously, and we compare both results and proceed to decide the direction of the research. That is an ideal case nowadays, I think. And then Dr. Tateshi is proceeding. This is another project chart, but improving the CFD method. And he is now doing LES simulation to do the more precise numerical work. And this is a case with LP turbine transient flow. And a very small chart, but there is an experimental results of the surface pressure, a Mach number on the surface Mach number, and this is an actual coordinate position on the blade. So by LES, he says there is very good agreement with the experimental data. By this method. And also, this is a transonic fan flow. It's the same configuration of the previous one. So he could detect some shock, very detailed shock structure like this. So it's a successful, and we want to use this method into this simulation of the original fan blade. But the problem is computational cost. Then we have a supercomputer here in our university. It's a very new one, and last year it was introduced in our installed in our university. And but by this supercomputer, this LES simulation takes a few days, and if we execute this kind of simulation, it takes several months or something. So one point. So that is practically impossible. So we would like to do some acceleration of the CFD simulation for further research work. But this is one direction to improve the turbulence model for precise numerical simulation. So we move on to the next topic. So we'll have a break here because it's a boundary of the topic. Okay. Okay, so the next topic is a trial research for the future technology. It's an active control of the cascade flutter. So it's a challenging one and not so realistic, but we pointed out a possibility of the flutter suppression with the piezoelectric device. So I'd like to show this research work and to enhance the understanding of the flutter phenomenon. Okay, so to suppress the flutter actively, the several researchers used the acoustic treatment, acoustic consideration. So in the past, the Professor Namba's group in Kyushu University, they tried to introduce the acoustic wave into flow field by actuator placed on a wall. So they can suppress the flutter. Flutter is a wavy propagation. So we can interrupt this one by acoustic signal actively. So that is a concept, a very natural concept. But sometimes it's successful, but sometimes unsuccessful and not. It's not definitely effective for the flutter suppression or control of the wave propagation. And the other one is Professor Sun's group in the Beihan University, Beijing University of Aeronautics and Astronautics. And they made a control on the acoustic impedance on the casing wall. So it means there is an acoustic lining on the fan duct, as you know, to suppress the fan noise. So this acoustic panel has some influence on the wavy motion of the instability. So they thought it must be beneficial to control the acoustic impedance of that casing wall to suppress the flutter propagation. So yes, sometimes it's also very effective to suppress the flutter. But anyway, these are the control on the flow field. So flow control is very, very difficult because flow itself is not so controllable. So that is somewhat ambiguous. So we thought, so we can control the flutter by controlling the structure side. That is more reliable, I think, we thought. So we tried some kind of control by numerical simulation first. And we thought the shape memory alloy may be usable. So by shape memory alloy, we can change the stiffness or shape by electrical heating. And also we tried to use piezoelectric devices. And piezoelectric device can be oscillated by the electric signal. And the first one is, yes, it's an effective, but it's an not strictly active control, but it's like passive because it's the shape change or stiffness change is translated into the blade design. So we thought it's not so active. So we changed it to piezoelectric device. It's a device for strain gauge, like strain gauge. And if we put the electric signal to this device, we can oscillate the structure actively. Okay. And so we tried the active oscillation of the blade trailing edge with the piezoelectric device. So. In the flutter situation, the blade starts to oscillate. So at that moment, we put the active oscillation add the active oscillation of the blade in some sense. So with this active oscillation, we can suppress this original blade oscillation by flutter. So that is our basic idea. And we executed a CFD simulation of this method, and it was successful. Then we verified the a part of that effect by the our wind tunnel test. Okay. So we submitted some papers in Isabella ACE. Okay. Yes.
While doing the physical application of this piezoelectric or shape memory alloy, at that time we need some electrical connection. So for the passing some electrical signal. So how we are going to take care of that thing?
Sorry, I don't understand you. Later, okay. Yes, and the objective and approach. The objective is to study the possibility of the active cascade flutter suppression through trailing edge oscillation with a piezoelectric device. And approach is, first one is numerical analysis by flow structure, coupled over flow structure interaction method, FSI method. And then the second, we did some experimental work in a transonic linear cascade tunnel. It's again the same cascade tunnel, but the bridge shape is same one. Okay, but in the numerical simulation we used another bridge shape. Okay, and the flow structure coupled method is yes, you already know. We have a moving grid system, and based on the initial grid we we execute the flow computation. It's in this case we need to the fast computation, so we used only the two-dimensional Euler equation because the this is a transonic case and the shock wave has a principal role. So we used the Euler equation only and neglected the viscous effect, and we can get the unsteady aerodynamic force by flow computation, and it's introduced to the structural computation. It's very simple structural model, and then we deform the grid, and then go back to the flow computation. This is a flow structure coupled method. It's an not fully coupled, but it's a weakly coupled simulation. And therefore, it was deep section of the Quiet Fan B. It's a NASA Quiet Engine program in the 1980s or something. Yes, and but we can get detailed data of the bridge shape from this project report. The inlet Mach number is 1.25, and the static pressure ratio is 1.7. It's a simulated Mach contours. So there is a very. It's a typical double shock. It's an oblique shock, leading edge oblique shock, and this is a passage shock. And we can see the passage shock is very strong here. So that is very easily used for our purpose. So it's a research braiding, so it's not good in terms of the efficiency, I think. The shock loss is very high. But we can use this one because this strong shock wave is very easy to treat. Okay, and yes, and this is a stability analysis S-curve, and the release frequency is 0.08 in translational mode, and it's interval phase angle, and we could have an unstable region here, around 90 degrees of IVPA. Okay. So this is done by the CFD work, yes, and we got the unsteady aerodynamic work. So you already know the methodology, okay? And at that, in this case, we plotted the unsteady aerodynamic work on the blade. It's a chord-wise position. And we can easily find the steep peak here. It's an exciting force in the positive side on the pressure surface. So this is around mid-chord position. So mid-chord position is here on the pressure side. So obviously, this is the effect of the shock oscillation, shock wave. And another part is here on the suction surface at 90% or something chord. And it's corresponding to here, suction surface. It's an the reflection point of the leading edge shock of the adjacent blade. So this is the second peak. But this peak is a governing factor of this instability. And the idea is here, if the passage shock movement is effectively controlled, the blade vibration stability may be changed. Okay. Because we have a strong shock wave here that from trailing edge to the mid chord. Okay. So if we can change the blade shape here or oscillate this part, we can change the shock oscillation. So that is a basic idea. So we will put the piezoelectric device here and actively oscillate a trailing edge and control the shock wave. That is idea. So we decided to have a flapping oscillation region that 30% chord length from trailing edge. And this angle phi is an angular displacement. And there is a parameter delta. It's not shown here, but delta is a phase difference between trailing edge oscillation and blade vibration. That is very important phase difference because it's blade itself is oscillating in the flatter situation. And then additionally, the trailing edge is oscillated by piezoelectric device. So there is a phase difference in between this blade vibration and trailing edge vibration. This phase difference is defined as delta. Okay, and this is an example of the demonstration of the piezo oscillation, trailing edge oscillation by a piezoelectric device. And first we did an analysis by flow structure coupling method. And we calculated the total energy of a blade by this. Okay, it's an potential energy and kinetic energy of the blade. If this energy input is larger than the threshold value, the trailing edge oscillation is switched on. So reduced frequency is fixed, and we used four flow channels. It's corresponding to the 90 degrees of interblade phase angle. So we used four channels flow field, and we put a periodic boundary here and here. So the IBPA is from 0 to 360 degrees. So if we set the periodic boundary here and here for four channels, there is a 90 degrees interblade phase angles between these adjacent two blades. Okay. So and all blades were set stationary in the initial situation, and then actual velocity distortion was put at the initial stage, and then by the flow structure coupled method, the blade starts to vibrate. And originally, this is an unstable case. So the blade displacement is growing with time. And then we put at a point of this one, if E is positive, so the piezo piezo oscillation is set on, and then we observe the behavior of the blade oscillation. That is what we did. And this is the final results. And these plots are the displacement, blade displacement, and unsteady aerodynamic force, both. And we have four blades here, number one, number two, number three, and number four. And we put the periodic boundary condition here and here. And number one and number three are, number one and number three are equipped braid with the piezoelectric device. And number two and number four are normal braid, no equipment. Okay. And this is a time against braid displacement of number one braid. And this is number two braid. Blue line is braid displacement. And this TS is the time period in which we put the velocity fluctuation. So from zero to here, we put the velocity fluctuation, and then it's returned to the uniform flow. And the braid is started vibrating here, and then we can observe the behavior after that. And in the number one braid, this braid displacement, blue line, and without control, results is shown by the dotted broken line. So we can see the displacement gradually increases here. That is an instability case. It's a flatter. And in this case, in number two braid, it's also in the instability, has instability like this. But we put and control here. We can see this solid line. So the displacement is gradually decreasing. This is a stable case. And also in this case, number two also is, the displacement is gradually decreasing. That is successful to suppress the flutter instability. And gray, the shade region is the time when a trailing edge is oscillated. It's actively oscillated here, here, here. And E, the energy was positive. Okay. So the we can, in the experiment, we couldn't input the active control on the oscillating braid. That is very complicated, difficult. So we did the experimental work on the original flutter test. And also, as in the separately, we did some piezo oscillation and detected the unsteady aerodynamic force induced by this piezo oscillation. And then we combined these data. Okay, so experimental apparatus is, as you already know, our transonic linear cascade tunnel. And in this case, we used double circular, not the NASA braid. because we didn't have such so sophisticated braid shape, so we used the double circular aqueous. So the purpose of this experiment is not completely the same case as the numerical simulation, but we'd like to show the possibility of the piezo technique to suppress the braid vibration. And this is a measurement system of the braid force. The stress gauge was put here to measure the aerodynamic force on the blade. And as unsteady aerodynamic work coefficient against interblade phase angle is shown here. In this case, we had a number zero braid data here. and number plus one and minus one. Yes, as I showed previously, the number plus one is minus one is here and plus one is here, and the resultant one is solid line. So we have an unstable case here. So we used this kind of unstable data situation to the piezo control. Okay. And this is a realistic oscillation realized by the piezoelectric device we used. So but it's an, a kind of ceramics. It's an, and we bought this part. And yes, this is a cross-sectional view. And we put a thin plate type piezoelectric device here on the suction surface and on the pressure surface also. And this is a photograph. And we put the electric signal from the outside to these two devices. So piezoelectric device, this type is not strong against the deformation. So it's a very, we must be very careful to treat it. And so we ordered the shape of this piezoelectric device along the blade shape. And the bottom is flat. Okay. So that is not so cheap, but it's, we could order that. And this is a displacement of the blade measured by the laser displacement gauge. And frequency was 40 hertz, and 210 volts is the voltage. And maximum displacement at the trailing edge is 0.115 millimeters. And we can see the large displacement region here and here. So it's not a trailing edge oscillation, but in reality, we had this kind of oscillation in the, our blade. So, of course, we can control the blade vibration by setting the another position or changing the device or something. It's an, it's not optimized here. But that initial stage, it's we thought it's enough. And then, this is an the result of the unsteady aerodynamic force measurement induced by the piezo oscillation. And it's a number zero blade, a central blade. And this is an it's an aerodynamic force against the frequency. And at the 40 hertz, we have a very big aerodynamic force. That is an it's a natural frequency of this system, the blade. Piezo blade, okay, and number minus one blade, number plus one blade. So by this oscillation, we can detect the very big influence at the number plus one blade, as we can see. And on the number minus one blade, it's always the signal influence is small. Okay, so because number zero and the plus one is a has principal roles on the induced red force. It's a very natural, understandable results. So anyway, we can have this kind of aerodynamic force, unsteady aerodynamic force, by the oscillation of the piezoelectric device. And then, we use some superposition for data analysis. And we have blade number zero. It's an, equipped with a piezo device. And the blade number zero was oscillated by piezoelectric device with the same frequency as that of the translational vibration of the blade. So in this configuration, we are using inference coefficient method. So we vibrate the number zero blade, and we measure the unsteady aerodynamic force on this blade and two knee bars, okay, as I showed yesterday. And we combine those three data, three blades data, into the one unsteady aerodynamic force by inference coefficient method. And this blade was oscillated by piezoelectric device, and the same frequency as the blade vibration. Okay, unsteady aerodynamic force was measured on the blades number zero and plus one and minus one, and unsteady aerodynamic work as a function of delta. So delta is the phase difference between the original blade vibration and the piezo vibration. So the W prime delta is a function of delta. So we have to watch this, the effect of delta, inference of delta. Okay, it's a phase difference between translational oscillation blade and the piezo oscillation. Okay, and then this is a data analysis of the aerodynamic work by piezo blade. Yes, this is an unsteady aerodynamic work in this way, piezo oscillation only. And we changed the K in the several times. And this is the piezo, or the phase difference between the piezo oscillation and blade oscillation. It's an unsteady aerodynamic work. So we can see that there is a very big effect, inference of delta on the induced aerodynamic work coefficient. So this is an exciting part, and this is damping part. So we need to use this damping part to suppress the blade oscillation. And if we put this kind of similar to piezo, we can enhance the flutter. So that is always for the active control, this is always the case. So we have to be careful to not enhance the instability. Okay. So and unsteady aerodynamic work was estimated by the superposition. The unsteady aerodynamic forces by blade vibration and piezo oscillation were separately measured and superposed afterwards. And a superposition of unsteady aerodynamic works by a translational vibration of blade plus piezo oscillation. And W total is here. W is the original, is induced work by original blade oscillation. And W prime is the is induced by the piezo oscillation. So if all blades are equipped with piezoelectric devices, we can have the W total by this equation. Okay. And the this chart figures show the linear independence of the piezo effect. So result A is the result of the superposition, and result B, the lines are the all blades are forced to oscillate with interrelated phase angle of 90 degrees with trailing edge oscillation. So in the original blade, result A, the result of the superposition, is here, black points on the pressure surface, and the white one is on a suction surface. And we can have it's a distance along chord. So we have a big peak. It's caused by the shock wave. And it's correspondent with the result B. It's all blades are forced to oscillate with the interbrain phase angle of 90 degrees. It's trailing edge equation. And the PS blade here. Yes, we can find the unsteady aerodynamic work is here in a positive one and positive one. So these kind of changes are detected. And finally, we we calculated the W total, and this is final result, unsteady aerodynamic work. And this is, it's as usual, the ordinate is an unsteady aerodynamic work coefficient, and obviously says interval phase angle sigma. And in the no control case is shown by a solid line here. It's the original one. So we can have an instability here and here. And in the stabilized, controlled case is we have two results. One is delta equal minus 60 degrees, and the other is delta equal 120 degrees. So it's delta is a phase difference between Bragg oscillation and Piazza oscillation. If we put the Piazza oscillation with delta of 120 degrees, we can have these results. So there is but small, but we have an effect of suppression from here to here. Okay, so the unstable work is reduced by Piazza oscillation, and the flatter region is slightly shrinked. Okay. And so that is a successful case. And but if we put the piezoelectric device oscillation with the delta of minus 60 degrees, so it's enhanced. So it's more unstable than the original case. Destabilization effect is obtained in a delta equal 60 degrees case. So we must be careful to do the proper control to the piezo oscillation. Okay. So finally, the conclusions are from the numerical study. The active control method with trailing edge oscillation was found to suppress the cascade flutter instability if the phase difference between the blade vibration and trailing edge oscillation was properly given. An on-off control procedure was successfully introduced for the active suppression of the vibration instability. But of course, we have to do some further progress into the rule of the control. And the experimental study, the suppression effect of the present method with the piezoelectric device was verified on blade vibration instability in transonic flow by linear cascade experiment. But this possibility was shown, clearly shown. So this is our trial for the active suppression. But we presented these results in the domestic conferences. And from the industry people, it has criticized that it's an impossible and also it's dangerous because there is some imbalance in the braid system. So the shaft vibration must be dangerous. So it's an impossible, they said. But when we presented it in the international conferences, many people had interest in this one. And after that, in Germany, some professors tried to use this technique to the suppression or control of the instability. And for instance, the Professor Zoime in Hannover University, they had a collaborated project with DLR. And he, actually, he installed the piezo device in the rotating machine, they put very high voltage to the piezo device, and they had a success to actively vibrate the rotating machine, the blade on the rotating machine. So the German technology is very high, I realized. So, yeah. And it's still now, it's not so practical, but it's a very interesting technique. And also it's important for future technology, we believe. Okay, so this is the final topic of my talk. So I showed the pressure-sensitive paint technology technique yesterday, but that was a first stage. But we have some progress recently. So I'd like to introduce our recent results or activity in this PSP technique. But we made this graphs only a few weeks ago, so I've not understood fully what's happening. So it's an maybe it's a discussion material for us. So I'm not so confident in this presentation. Okay. So first one is it's a review of the PSP technique. So we are using anodized aluminum pressure sensitive paint AAPSP in the present research. It has the fastest response time in order of 10 microseconds. And luminophore is has an excitation frequency of the wavelength is 460 nanometers, and the emission is 615 nanometers. Okay, so that means we have to use a bandpass filter here. The light source is a metal halide light source, and there is a bandpass filter on excitation frequency, and we excite that luminescence, and the emitted light is captured by high-speed camera, but it's 615 nanometer. So we put the high-pass filter here to cut a lower light than this emission. Okay, and the binder is a porous aluminum, as I showed. The pore diameter is 20 nanometers, and thickness is 10 to 11.3 nanometers. There is a hole, many holes on the blade surface. It's the pore diameter, it's average pore diameter and average thickness is like this. And this is an APSP, and it's a view. And monochrome high-speed camera is used for capturing PSP images and optical filter set. And we are using the metal halide light, but now we will change. We are changing it to the LED lamp. So because we want to have a more powerful light source, so by for instance, by having the more capability for a high frequency case. But we can use the laser light sheet, laser light. We calculated the necessary power of laser, but it's too high for handling by students, so it's dangerous. So we'd like to use the LED. And I read some papers, and in the many universities, the LED is popular. So they don't use a laser. I think it's because of not only the cost, but also the safety, I think. So we are now changing to the blue LED lamp. But up to now, we are still using metal halide light. And this is a rear view of the blade oscillation. Okay. And these black markers are the reference points to detect the deformation of the blade for data processing. And this is a piezo blade, so we can see some images of the pressure distribution. So yes, we can look at the shock movement by our eyes. So it's a very interesting experience for us. Okay, and image processing procedure is also improved from the original one. So the first image capture, it's a wind-on and wind-off image. Yes, take PSP photos by camera. And wind-on image, it's the intensity I, and off image is I reference. And then we cut the blade surface here. And then edge detection and fin transmission is done, as I explained yesterday. So correct impact of deformation by transforming blade surface into same rectangle, wind-on image and wind-off image. And then use serial averaging filter to reduce the spatial noise for both images. And divide the I, and we calculate I ref over I at each pixels and calibrate by Stanford equation and by in situ method. This is a Stanford expression or equation. And we can get the pressure data by this intensity ratio. And C0 and C1 are calibration coefficients. And there are pressure taps. We use the pressure taps data on here. And this is a calibration curve of the PSP signal. And we can calculate the pressure distribution. Okay. But we need to detect the blade shape in the oscillation very precisely. So in the former technique, it's not sufficiently correct. So we changed it to the new one. And yes, we put the blade surface mark here is a dotted blade and a PSP blade. And in the stationary blade, we can get this kind of shape. But oscillating blade, we get original image and searching the boundary, and the dot is also searched. And then interpolate it and affine transformation. So this kind of dot searching must be improved to get the precise shape of the blade at the every moment of the oscillation. And so we need to, the pixel-to-pixel image registration here. And then we can get this kind of unsteady image like this. And we have dots here, in here. Okay, so in this technique, so automatic blade positioning, we use the Hall transform based edge detection. Hall transform is a feature extraction technique, and we can find characteristic shapes by a bolting procedure in a parametric space. It's a very famous transformation, so we can read some textbooks. And transfer gaps and the intensity of image noise. And for cascade blade, the outline is obvious, and in sudden shape, line, circle, arc, or cubic curve. So it's a gamma correction. Oh, okay. What's happened here? Okay. So there is a gamma correction and binarization with Bersen methods, and we get then edge detection. It's an canny edge detector. It's included in this transformation technique. And cleaning, and then how transformation at the second order precision is made. And finally, the edge point coordinates are calculated very precisely. And this is done in the every time steps and it's an unsteady one. Okay. And this is a blade shape in the one period of the oscillation. Okay. This is a very sophisticated program for the detection of the blade position or blade shape. Okay. And this is the final results. It's an pixel number, and it's against time, and wind off and wind on images. So they have we have very good correlation. Okay. And then our fin transmission is made based on these shape data. Okay. Yeah. And it's an the Hall transform based edge detection during the blade vibration. So, because it's, as you saw in the previous video, the blade is not strictly stationary at the non-vibration case also. So in that case also, we need to have a very precise blade shape or blade position. So this kind of detection is every time used. For during this process, and the verification of the image processing method by CFD and video, so CFD video. Okay. And by CFD video, we can use the same. Kind of simulation, simulated, we can have the same kind of results by CFD. And we compare the CP or unsteady CP data between CFD and image processing. So we can see this CFD data is plotted by the solid line. And image processing data is plotted by red circles. So CP is completely correspondent. And the real part, the imaginary part of the unsteady CP is very well. But sometimes, but in this case, the phase is doesn't match well. But in total, the correspondence is satisfactory between the CFD and image processing. Okay. And the current image processing methods are effective for blade deformation and oscillation processing with a satisfactory accuracy. Okay. And also, we visualized, the flow visualization was done for several pressure ratios. So in the original one, we did only this one, but we changed the pressure ratio. And we'd like to understand what's happening at the blade, on the blade for flatter case. So we changed the pressure ratio, and we observed the flow field and measured the unsteady aerodynamic force. And this is an oil flow measurement, and it's a pressure surface and suction surface. And then in these cases, the oblique shock, oblique shock foot is seen on the suction surface here, with a thin and a curved separation line shape. And a passage shock feed can be observed in both pressure surface and suction surface. This is downstream separation area here. And and move upstream with pressure ratio increase. Okay, pressure ratio increase, this line is the shock feed, passage shock feed is going upstream. And with the increase in the pressure ratio, the passive shock merges with oblique shock, and shock foot becomes a straight line on suction surface. Yes, you already know from the yesterday's talk. And finally, it's a near-detached shock wave. So under detached shock condition, the shock foot on pressure surface disappeared. Okay, so no this kind of boundary here. And the increase with the increase in pressure ratio, the corner separation is visible and grows bigger with the increase in pressure ratio. And also in the tip side, it's on pressure side, okay. Yeah, and both corner separation. And on the tip side, we can see the influence of the tip leakage flow. And it grows, the affected region grows with the increase in the pressure ratio. So we have three flow features. One is shock wave movement, and the second is corner separation, and third is the influence of the tip leakage flow. That is so characteristics, features of this flow field. And then, we compare the result with the CFD. Okay. And as you can see, it's in these views, we can say its correspondence is very well. Okay. And the influence of the, for instance, the corner separation and also the tip leakage can be detected. So in general, the CFD and experiment has a good correlation in this case. Okay. And the shock wave is visualized by oil flow and CFD, and Schüli and photo and CFD. It's a pressure surface and the suction surface. Some correlation is very well. And in this field, the Schülerian photo for vertical gradient and horizontal gradient, both are very good, good agreement. Okay, and it's a double shock, oblique shock and passage shock pattern. And okay, so next one is steady pressure analysis with between experimental and CFD. So okay, so I have a second break here, and I'd like to continue this talk, the final hour. Thank you.
Those who are working, they are using that in your laboratory for safety analysis.
Yes, yes.
So, your team to develop or like some of them?
Yeah, a lot of them. Yes.
So, in house.
So in our last lecture, we were discussing on modular approach.
Welcome. Now, so welcome back. Welcome back. So we'll be.
We have discussed.
Yeah. Okay. So, as shown in this page, we can visualize and understand the shock behavior, shock position, shock behavior by oil flow visualization, and Schwerin pictures, and CFD. That these kind of data are combined to promote our understanding of the flow field. And also, we can look at the corner separation here and here, and also the separation and here. So shockwave and separation can be easily shown in this oil flow visualization and also CFD simulation. And next one is steady pressure analysis. It's a validation of the PSP and CFD. So we compared the results of PSP and CFD and also some other data. For instance, this is the total aerodynamic force coefficient against the static pressure ratio from 1.15 to 1.4, it's so the shock position is changes along these lines, and three data are plotted together. The first one is strain gauge data, it's here, open circle, and PSP data is this purple circle line, and CF data is these green line and symbols. So we can see a very good agreement among these three kinds of the techniques, okay, and very good agreement. And also we can see the aerodynamic force is linearly increasing with the increase in the static pressure ratio. That is the findings from this results. And these figures show the mid-span CP distribution against chord-wise positions and CP for several pressure ratios. It's a steady case, and experimental results are detected by the pressure taps data, and PSP data and CFD results are plotted together. So all three have a very good comparison among these three methods. And in the detached shock case, we didn't do the PSP measurement. So the experiment and CFD are compared here. And also there is very good agreement between two data. And this is the surface CP distribution measured by the PSP and obtained by the CFD results. So there's the strength of a CP value is there is a small difference, but in general, there are very good agreement with PSP data and CFD results, okay? And also this is the suction surface results, and we could have a very good agreement between CFD and PSP. And this is an oil flow results, and as I said, there is a shock and corner separation, and the inference of tip leakage flow. Okay. And there is an correlated results in the CFD also. So we can see some inference of the tip leakage flow on the pressure field obtained by CFD and PSP. It's an detected by the oil flow results also. Okay, so there is good correspondence between these results. And this is a shockwave position. And from the PSP CFD results, we can see the details of the shock foot flow field. And we can easily see the inference of the shock band layer interaction, and band layer is thickened rapidly here. And maybe there is some small separation here and reattachment. Okay. So this kind of detailed flow features can be seen based on the CFD results. That is a good thing of this usage of CFD. Okay, and then this mass flow rate changes with pressure ratio. It's a kind of characteristics map. And this is plotted the static pressure ratio here and mass flow rate here. And also the Mach number is here and mass flow rate. And so the pressure ratio is here. And pressure ratio is decreased, and mass flow rate increases. And first, the mass flow rate increases, and pressure ratio decreases here. And after that, it's an pressure ratio decreases, but mass flow rate is the same. It's an choke condition, and the back pressure is here, and the range, it's a low mass flow rate. The static pressure ratio is increase with increasing mass flow rate. Okay, so we can see this kind of mass flow rate characteristics against the pressure ratio, and these are the graphs show the Mach number. it's an pitchwise position. It's a flow angle, the pitchwise position. So, in this, for instance, for several pressure ratios, so we can see the pressure ratio. If the pressure ratio changes, but even if the pressure ratio changes, the Mach number then is the same, almost the same, and the incidence angle is almost the same. But in the near detached shockwave pressure ratio, its flow angle is changed. But in the other cases, it's a unique incidence range. The upstream Mach number and the flow angle keep very similar against the pressure ratio. And it's a shockwave pattern. In the compressed operation, the various operating conditions are corresponded with the different shockwave patterns. The dominant flow phenomenon in transonic cascade with consideration of both energy loss and the pressurization capability. So this is a density gradient. It's obtained by the CFD results. And we have a shock pattern here. It's an oblique shock. And there is an it's near choke condition, so it's an trailing edge, near trailing edge. There is an passage shock, and it's a shock, deflected shock, and then it's moved like this, with increasing the shock back pressure. Okay, again, it's very clear. From near choke to detached shock. Okay, and shockwave pattern is pressure ratio is 1.05 to 1.41. So it's a near choke and a double shock pattern, and the passage shock goes upstream and merge. Yeah. Okay. Its order is here, here, and here, here. And we can understand the continuously the change in the shock pattern by this CFD simulation. So we call this a choked flow and double shock pattern and merged shock pattern and near detached shock pattern. But in this free detached shock pattern, it's we cannot do the experimental work by this detached shock pattern, because the shock wave is not stable and very intensely oscillate near the leading edge. So we couldn't do the experiment in this shock pattern. It's again the shock patterns. And so merged shock waves, that there is an oblique shock, and there is an expansion wave here, and oblique shock here, and there is an passage shock. And there is a shock boundary area interaction, and some separated region can be detected, and there is a wake. And this is a double shock wave pattern. There is an oblique shock, leading edge shock, and expansion wave here. And passage shock is seen here. And so in the many cases, there is a shock, foot is like this shape due to the shock band area interaction. And there is a small separated region here. And after passive shock, it's a flow is subsonic, and there is a shock band area interacted separation, and then wake. And this is a typical pattern of double shock waves. So choked, double shock, and merged, and near detached shock. And we are focusing on these two shock patterns in our PSP measurement up to now. So it's another part. It's a tip leakage flow and hub corner separation in the CFD results. And this is a turbulent kinetic energy is plotted by color. And the tip side and hub side and pressure ratio is changed. Yeah? And in the tip side, we can see the tip leakage flow towards downstream. Oh, it's upstream and downstream. And tip leakage flow goes to the downstream braid here. This is one pattern which Professor Mistry explained on Tuesday's lecture. And in the hub side, we can see the corner separation here and very big one with the merged shocks and double shock also. Okay. So we have a tip leakage flow and hub corner separation. Very clearly we can see it. And the oscillation characteristics in the wind-off condition. And this is this graph shows the vibration mode. So the unsteady for aerodynamic force coefficient against oscillating frequency. It's an the amplitude and phase. So the inertial force was measured by the strain gauge in the wind off condition. So it's from 20 hertz to 320 hertz. So we are using this part, so low frequency cases, because of this. So we have very steep peak here at 220 hertz. That is a resonance point of our blade. And the phase is changed rapidly at the resonance point. So yes, it's a fast structure frequency. The amplitude peak of inertial force appears around 220 hertz, and the phase changes from 0 to 180. That is a typical feature of the resonance. And then we chose this low frequency part. But we visualized, observed the braid vibration at 40 hertz and 240 hertz. So it looks like the same, but there is a difference. Can you realize that? In the low frequency case, it's on a solid plate, like solid plate. At 240, there is a deformation of the braid. So that is a supercritical or super resonance condition. So we didn't use this oscillation. Only this oscillation was forecast. Okay. So from our results, from 0 to 140 hertz, we could have a rigid translational vibration. So we limit the higher frequency at 140 hertz. And again, this is a flow condition selection. It's a characteristics. So as I said, we chose this merged shock pattern around here and double shock pattern around here. So it's very clearly, it's a mass flow rate and Mach number against the static pressure ratio. It's very clearly shown here. Okay. And this is an example of the unsteady pressure data by piezo, by a PSP and CFD results. It's a 40 hertz, and it's an number braid number zero suction surface of the braid number zero shown here, real part and imaginary part, and the pressure surface of the number plus one is shown here, real part and imaginary part. These are PSP results, and in the same condition we draw the results of the CFD here. So you can see, very similar or well correspondent results between PSP data and CFD data. And this is a cut of at the mid-span position. And this is a CP real part and CP imaginary part against the code-wise positions. And PSP is black line and CFD is red line. So, yes, overall, we can have very good correlation. Of course, there is several discrepancies between two data in the detailed case, but detailed positions. But in general, so there is a good correlation we can have. And this is an unsteady aerodynamic force comparison in the double shock waves pattern. Pressure ratio is 1.25. So the coefficient of is CF. The amplitude is plotted in the left-hand side, and the phase is plotted in the right-hand side against reduced frequency K. So the three braids, braid number 0 and minus 1 plus 1, are measured and plotted there. The data are plotted here. And strain gauge results is a solid line. And PSP results is a red circle. And CFD results is green circle. So we can see very good correlation of each other. But be careful. On braid zero, we don't plot the PSP results because it's not well measured up to now because of the limitation of the. We think it's limited by the intensity of the light source. So we are changing the light source to have a good results on the oscillating blade. But for the stationary blade, there is very good correlation. And in this case, it's a curious, it's very wavy pattern of the phase shift in the blade minus one, and there is a very big error bar. But is it because we can see this amplitude is very small at minus one blade. So as I said previously, so braid minus one is not much affected by the oscillation of the braid number zero. So signal induced force is very small at minus one braid. So that is why the value is very small. And the phase shift is not correctly measured by this. But for the we are using the inference coefficient method. So the inference coefficient from braid minus one is very small. So it's not so effective on the overall calculation, evaluation of the unsteady aerodynamic force. Okay. So, and yes, from these results, we can observe the shockwave movement based on the braid vibration. Okay. And we focused on the merged shock pattern and double shock pattern here. And in the double shock case, when blade zero moves downwards, the shock wave goes to the downstream. So the pressure is reducing, and then shock wave goes downstream here in this case. But in the merged shock case, if the blade zero goes down, the pressure increases in this part of the cascade. So normal shock goes upstream. So it's a completely different behavior of the shock wave in these two patterns. Well, that is very interesting findings from our results. So that is very, very influential to the flat Earth instability. So the phase of the shock oscillation due to the blade oscillation. That is a very important point. And based on this knowledge, we compare the unsteady pressure field. It's a double shock wave pattern and merged shock wave pattern. It's a CFD results. It's a real part and imaginary part, real part, imaginary part. So we can see, for instance, the blade plus one hour here, we can clearly see that the change in color of the pressure field. Okay. It's also minus and plus, it's a CP of the phase is different. So the color is changed. Okay. So that is a very important point findings in this computation. And this is a near tip wall. And near tip, it's an we can have some CP unsteady pressure here, merged shock wave pattern. It's an inference, it's probably the inference of the tip leakage flow. At the hub region, we have some signals here, and it comes from the separation, corner separation. But the strongest CP is induced by the shock oscillation, of course. And it's an analysis of the phase shift at 40 hertz in the merged shockwave patterns. And it's an CFD results, and phases are here. And so we can see the phase change between the two adjacent flow channels. But it's the explanation is very hard. But we can see that phase shift between the flow channels by this analysis. And afterward, we calculated the unsteady aerodynamic work based on the CFD results. And in the CFD, we can use the all blade data from blade zero to minus 3 and plus 3. And total is black lines. So this is an unsteady work against interblade phase angle. So we can see the unstable region here. Okay. This and the PSP helped understanding the shockwave movement and validate the quality of CFD method. So we used CFD to evaluate the unsteady aerodynamic work. And inference coefficient method was used based on the CFD results by using seven blades. And okay, so we found the unstable IBPA region here, like this. And the most unstable work is found at the 106 degrees of IBPA. And at that IBPA, we are looking at the unsteady aerodynamic work distribution on the braid. It's an all braids, the pressure surface and suction surface. So these are unstable region, and we can see the unstable zones include -1 braid suction surface. It's an oblique shockwave and a passive shockwave areas here. And +1 pressure surface, the supersonic zone. And +1 suction surface and +2 pressure surface. It's a passage shockwave zone, including the impact of tip leakage flow and hub corner separation, because it's not two-dimensional. And this part is affected by the corner separation. And also this part is affected by the tip leakage flow. So it's a shock and leakage flow and corner separation. These are the factors of these instability, unstable zone. And so at the other IBPA, it's also unstable, but 132 degrees, the same analysis was done. So in this case, on -1 pressure surface, there's a passage shock wave. And +1 to +3 pressure surface, it's a passage shock wave area and tip leakage flow. And +1 to +3 suction surface here, it's a merged shock waves area and tip leakage flow. And tip leakage region. Okay. And also, we checked the unsteady aerodynamic force on each blade for double shock waves pattern and the merged shock waves pattern. Okay. And this frequency is changed from 40 hertz to 1,000 kilohertz. So the dominant braid with maximum unsteady aerodynamic force changes from braid 1 to braid 0 with frequency increases. But anyway, braid 0 and braid 1 is dominant braids. And braid 0 is always doing negative work with a negative phase value in the merged shock and double shock both patterns. So these kind of findings are obtained by this calculation. Okay. And in the total, this unsteady work on each blade. And it's a blade number 0 to -3 to +3. And so number 0 is always negative. So at high frequency, it's 100 hertz or something, the negative work done by braid 0 can contract all the positive works done by the other braids. So on the other braids, there is a positive unsteady work. But the negative work by braid 0 is very large, so it's compensated with these plus positive unsteady works. So the system becomes all IBPA range stable. So these are the roles of the each braid on the unsteady work. And unsteady work variation with the pressure ratio. So it's an IBPA against unsteady work, and it's a changing pressure ratio, and it's a braid number, and pressure ratio is changed. So IBPA of a maximum positive unsteady work point has a tendency to increase with pressure ratio. So pressure ratio increases, the most unstable point is increasing. Okay. Okay, so the major findings of our recent PSP-based study was summarized here. The PSP results showed the qualitative agreement qualitative agreement with the CFD results, while the results in the large pressure fluctuation areas near shock showed also the quantitative accordance, very good accordance. And the second one, the shock wave oscillation is the dominant sources of the unsteady pressure. And the third one is the shock wave moving direction of the double shocks pattern, and the merge shocks pattern is different due to the different mass flow rate characteristics. That is very important findings. And lastly, the shock waves and tip leakage flow were considered as the dominant factors of aerodynamic instability. The first importance is, of course, shock, but for three-dimensional consideration, the tip leakage flow also has very big influence on the instability. That is our recent findings. But in this case, as you see, there is a method of the strain gauge and the PSP measurement and CFD. So all these so possible techniques must be included as merged into our understanding and knowledge. That is the current hopeful methods of the studies of these kind of complicated phenomena. So we'd like to continue this work for free understanding of the full understanding of the shock associated or near stall flutters for future. That is my desire. Okay, so this is the last part. So I'd like to conclude my whole lecture by these comments. The first one is Turbomachinery flutter is always a critical issue. And nowadays, it's more critical. And for future, some engineers say we need to include the flutter consideration or flutter tolerant consideration into the original design. So for that, we need the deep knowledge on the flutter phenomenon, of course. The second one is the adequate flutter prediction is understanding of the fundamental phenomena underneath the emerged vibration problems. That is, of course. So for this purpose, for this point, as I said, the some theoretical consideration is also very important for dividing the critical phenomenon or factors involved in the flutter phenomenon in front of us. That is a very important point. And the third one is a numerical approach and experimental study must be closely collaborated. And in that sense, the industry-academia collaboration should be essential. So in our case, the fun ring test was executed by IHI, and IHI fortunately provided the data to us. And we did our numerical simulation and so compared together, and we found the discrepancy and made a discussion with the engineers. So and so that is an could promote our understanding of the current stage. So for future, we'd like to do the experimental work and numerical work in parallel, simultaneously. And comparison is done every time. And then we can understand, we can promote the understanding of the real phenomena. So in that sense, so hopefully we ourselves can do that whole things. But it's practically it's impossible. So, for instance, we don't have fan ring test facility, so it's very hard for academia. So, so in the solution is the collaboration between industry and university, Now that is very important. It's more important for in the future, so I think. And the fourth one is currently the available experimental data are quite limited. That is another very important point, problem. So we can have several test cases for CFD validation. That is okay. But we need more complicated simulation. So in that case, we cannot have an base data, experimental data, for validation. So it means, so complicated means the realistic situation. For instance, the pressure or temperature and rotating speed and also the size. So in these kind of things to be real condition, the cost is very high. But industry can do that sometimes. But in my view, we need some national project. So it's a government project to establish such kind of test facility or do such kind of sophisticated experiment. So in Japan, we are looking for such kind of opportunity to have a collaborative project, research project, to get the experimental data, sophisticated experimental data. It's, again, the industry-academia collaboration, but not only one industry, but many industries and academia are involved in one project. That is, the organization is very, very important for the future program. This is fourth point. And the fifth point, the stall rate vibration is a big issue to be clarified. Yes, as I showed you. So it's very, very complicated flow feature. It's like a rotating stall. So yes, it's very important, and the interesting thing is the flutter and rotating stall is simultaneously exists. So the flutter initiation in the area of rotating stall. That kind of phenomenon is, I think, it's in the real world, it occurs. But we cannot approach this kind of areas at the current stage. So we like to do such kind of analysis on the stall region with red vibration. So it's a very big issue. And then the sixth one is lightweight thin composite rates bring new focuses, as I explained. For instance, the mode shape change due to the flow, airflow, or non-synchronous vibration. And in our code, which used for the flutter prediction, is usable for this kind of things because we can change the structure characteristics in the simulation. And we did some kind of trial by this code. It was successful. So by use of this kind of simulation method, we can do extend our knowledge to this kind of unknown factors for composite brace or something. But it's an still now it's an open problem, so not yet well studied. It's a future issue. And the final one is complicated situations, for instance, multi-stage or intake inference. Should we take it into account for precise prediction? It's an as a discussion in, for instance, the ASME Tower Expo nowadays. It's an, as I said, the inference of the inlet boundary. So there is a reflected wave that comes back to the fan. That is a very big influence on the flutter instability. And also in the multi-stage situation, there is an influence, of course, from upstream braids or downstream braids. So in this case, it's a very, very big computation. So it's hard still now. So we are focusing on only one braid row or one stage for flutter computation. So in the future, we, of course, need the multi-stage consideration also. So anyway, so back to the first one. So tower machine flutter is always a critical issue, and we have many things to do for future. So you young guys, young ladies also, please do these kind of things with us, and get a good performance and good CO2 reduction for future globe. Thank you very much for your kind attention.